Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Hellfire, the story of Australia, Japan, and the prisoners of war. Written by Cameron Forbes and read by Peter Byrne. The dedication reads, "For Anne." The moral right of the author has been asserted. Chapter 1, A Different Courage. Men will sacrifice occupations and other things to go to war, where they can fight as soldiers and gain a little of the glory of war. General Gordon Bennett. Nightjar's call. It is the changing of the guard for jungle creatures, and soon there are new bird songs. Pale light touches the top of teak trees and giant bamboo, but in the cutting it is dark still. Candlelight plays on the old faces of men and on rocks rough-hewn by hand. Kevin Ward is here. It is April 25, Anzac Day, 2003. Ward tasted a little of what some generals like to call the glory of war. Saw blood on the bayonet, bodies tattered and battered by machine gun bullets and mortar bombs. Saw mates and enemy die for distant king and emperor in ambush at Gemas on the Malayan Peninsula in 1942. Brief glory quickly became inglorious defeat in Singapore, Britain's greatest military humiliation. Kevin Ward was transformed from Australian frontline soldier to prisoner of war. On this day in 1943, a batch of Australians stood in a jungle clearing on the first day of a new phase of their lives as slaves of their Japanese captors. They would clear jungle along this mountainside in Thailand, gnaw through limestone ridges, pile up embankments, and build bridges. They would be part of an army of 61,000 Allied prisoners, British, Australian, Dutch, a handful of Americans, and 250,000 Asian labourers carving a railway to Burma, as Japan desperately tried to hold the ground it gained in its amazing blitzkrieg and to push the war into the huge prize of India. Hellfire Pass, 60 years on. Ward, other survivors, widows, friends, young regular soldiers who were at Anzac Cove, Gallipoli, the previous year, and who have found a new place of pilgrimage, await the dawn service. In 1943, for months, there was no night in Hellfire Pass. Flares, carbide lamps, and bamboo fires lit workers, men near naked and skeletal, and guards with bamboo staves. Elongated shadows twisted and danced up rock faces and into the jungle. There were shouts of "Spiro!" and screams. But now, a minister breaks the hush. "We are assembled here in the presence of Almighty God to remember before Him with thanksgiving the honoured dead who gave up their lives for their country." Later, the last post sounds. The dead were many. The railway was built to the sound of the last post. The bugle sang to rest Wally Malvina, father of eight, released from the agony of cholera, and Mickey Hallam, punched, kicked, beaten with bamboo staves and with wooden clogs, pulped by Japanese engineers. More than 12,000 Allied prisoners died, along with a guest at 90,000 Asian impressed labourers, brutalised and betrayed by the Japanese, who boasted that they would liberate them from the European imperialists and embrace them in the Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere. The Thai-Burma Railway stretched 415 kilometres, built northwest from Nong Pladuk in Thailand and southeast from Tan Bayusayat in Burma, to link the existing systems in the two countries. only a short section still operates. Irresistible monsoons tore down embankments. Konkoita, where the line was joined, lies under the surface of man-made Kaoleum Lake, and the jungle has obliterated much of the path of misery and death. Yet the memory of the railway burns, and it binds Australia and Japan in a fraught relationship. Hellfire Pass has been reclaimed from the jungle and is a memorial not only to those who suffered and those who died along the railway, but to all the men and women held in the diaspora of Japanese prisoner of war camps on Ambon and Sandakan, most of them doomed, in Java, Sumatra and Hainan, and in Japan itself as mine and factory fodder, senior officers in Taiwan and Manchuria, and the nurses in Sumatra, only a third of whom would survive the sinking of their ship, massacre, disease and maltreatment. Wally Mulvina died on May the 23rd, 1943, at a camp known as Shimosonkurai, 20 kilometres from the crossing to Burma at Three Pagodas Pass. He was 45. Cholera kills quickly, draining body and spirit. It was the most feared of the diseases that preyed on the prisoners of war, and Mulvina spent his last night isolated on a small rise called Cholera Hill. Now, the view from Cholera Hill is across paddy fields and the serene waters of Kaoleum Lake to spectacular sawtooth mountains along the Thai-Burma border. In the foreground, the railway embankment on which he worked briefly is clearly discernible under a cloak of grass and small shrubs as it emerges from the lake. It loses shape further up the valley. While Mulvina was a prisoner, momentous things were happening. On the seas in May and June in 1942, Japanese naval superiority was shattered in the battles of the Coral Sea and Midway. On land, in the last months of the year, at Milne Bay, along the Kokoda Trail and at Bunar, Australians were proving that Japanese soldiers were not invincible. New legends of the digger were being created. But Mulvina and his mates were fighting a different war, with a different courage. For Australians, Gallipoli the defeat is the defining element of World War I. Young men from a young country showed such spirit and bravery under fire that they helped build a nation. As the old soldiers have faded away, the myth has grown, and the Anzac Day crowds have swollen. In World War II, there was much battlefield bravery too, even during the debacle that was the struggle to save Singapore. Here is the story of Charles Anderson. He started the war a decorated hero. Born in South Africa, he won the Military Cross fighting with the King's African Rifles against German-led Askari natives. He migrated to Australia and joined the Citizen Military Forces. And in combat against the Japanese in the Battle of Muar in January 1942, won the Victoria Cross, the Empire's highest award for bravery. The citation reads, in part, "During the operations in Malaya, from the 18th to the 22nd of January, Lieutenant Colonel Anderson, in command of a small force, was sent to restore a vital position and to assist a brigade. His force destroyed 10 enemy tanks. When later cut off, he defeated persistent attacks on his position by ground and air forces and forced his way through the enemy lines to a depth of 15 miles. He was again surrounded and subjected to very heavy and frequent attacks, resulting in severe casualties to his force. He personally led an attack with great gallantry on the enemy, who were holding a bridge, and succeeded in destroying 4 guns. Lieutenant Colonel Anderson, throughout all this fighting, protected his wounded and refused to leave them. Throughout the fighting, which lasted for 4 days, he set a magnificent example of brave leadership, determination, and outstanding courage." But now, consider this story from the Thai-Burma Railway, told by Ray Parkin. Parkin had been steering the Australian light cruiser Perth at crucial stages in the gallant battle against a Japanese invasion fleet in the Java Sea on March 1, 1942. The Perth sank. 352 of the crew died, and Parkin was one of the 320 survivors. After capture, he was sent to work on the railway. It was July 1943 at Hintock, not far from Hellfire Pass. Two men on a work party had collapsed with malaria, another with cholera. Parkin eventually persuaded a petulant, brutal Japanese guard to allow the two men with malaria to help the man with cholera to the shelter of a cave 450 metres away. He managed to get the three standing up in a wobbly tripod. I watched them go, the two malarias with the cholera about their necks. They were bowed and sweating with pain and concentration, trying not to collapse. The man with cholera was limp between them, with his head lifelessly on his chest, hanging like a crucified man. His knees were buckled and his feet dragged. His trousers, which were ripped across in two places, revealing his skinny, fouled buttocks and stringy thighs, were unbuttoned at the waistband. And as the others dragged him with slow and shambling gait, his pants kept falling about his knees. The two men had to stop and pull them up before they could go on. One of the malarias reached over and pulled them up. They wobbled, then they all fell over. Slowly they dragged themselves up again and staggered along the cutting until they came to the cave. Later, the stretcher party, making their fourth trip, came out and picked up the cholera. And so, step by step and day by day, the prisoners of war fought their battles for survival, often, most of them, in ignorance of what was happening in the wider world, trapped in a terrible cocoon of pain, boredom, and sometimes shame, and sometimes guilt. Back in Australia, many of the families of the prisoners lived in ignorance too. Letters went into the void. Rare, cryptic messages came out, so delayed that there was no way of knowing whether the senders were alive or dead. In 1942, Doris Malvina received word that Wally was missing, believed prisoner of war. Then nothing. But through those long years, she always believed he would come home. He would see Gwen, last born, for the first time. Then, in June 1945, she was told he'd died 2 years before. And with peace only a month away, six words, just six, from poor dead Wally, a postcard the Japanese allowed him to write, undated, said, "I am well. We have concerts." They did have concerts and mock Melbourne Cup horse races. They practiced graveyard humour in the face of oppression and the tyranny of dragging time. They survived as an act of will. Like foot soldiers down the ages, they had suffered at the hands of their military and political leaders. Generals had plotted against fellow generals. Allied leaders squabbled. Blunders, jealousies, and of course, the great lie that Britannia ruled the waves and Singapore, her splendid naval base, was an impregnable fortress, helped deliver them into captivity. There, they died in tragic numbers. In World War II, 550,000 Australians served in the different theatres. 19,000, 3%, were killed in action. Of the 22,000 taken prisoner by the Japanese, 8,000 died, 36% of them. When the survivors blinked their way into freedom after the atomic bombs had done their work, they found there had been seismic shifts. Australia, having seen its duty and security in fighting Britain's battles on Veldts, Flanders fields, and Middle Eastern deserts, had turned to fight for its survival in the region in which it lived. It had attached itself to a new, great and powerful friend. The long-feared thrust by the yellow hordes to the north had been faced and overcome. But the days of White Australia were numbered. Old empires were giving their death rattles, and a new Asia was emerging.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.